Not too bad. How are you?
Happy New Year.
Thank you.
Thinking about
right. What's your name?
Holly.
Have you been here? You look familiar.
before Christmas.
Okay.
The holiday. Thank you.
Space and energy. I don't know. I mean, I don't know. I do know that clutter, especially if it's personal clutter, could make it difficult on one. Could make it difficult. I mean, that's, you know what I mean? I mean, say you're at home and there's a sink full of dirty dishes, for example, and it's your job in the family to do the dishes, it could make it difficult to get your writing done because your eyes keep darting over to the sink. I'm assuming that your apartment's the size of mine. Like, you can see the sink from your desk, you know? And I'm looking over there going, you know? So I do know that clutter sometimes could make it difficult to focus on your work. But I don't know. I mean, I really think it's the size of your, of your bandwidth. Can we talk about the spatial relationship to the mind?
You talked about how far characters were from you.
Right, yes. Now I remember you were sitting like right over there.
Yeah,
and you talked
there
about,
was
yeah,
another a writer here.
Yes.
Who said that she felt very far away from her, or you said that maybe she was far away from her characters because she was thinking too big picture.
Right.
And I feel like I'm really close.
Right. Right.
But I'm curious about time, you know, like if you're in a coffee shop, there's a pace to that.
Right.
Versus like in a silent room.
Right.
I don't know.
Right.
How
I would,
you?
Oh, yes, 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 and.
Don't overthink it. Yeah. Yeah.
Exactly. Except that, you know, if you really think, if you think, well, I need a perfect ivory tower to get my work done. You're setting yourself up for a life in an ivory tower, or seeking out ivory towers. I mean, we wouldn't want to lay that on you. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So you kind of like bloom where you're planted, go with the flow. But if you have a preference and it's easy to manifest for yourself, then I would say, if you prefer coffee shops to libraries and both are readily available, then definitely go to the coffee shop. But I think that with some helpers, like some earplugs, not earphones that send like music or whatever, but actual, that quiet down the noise, you can sort of find the space in your head. That's really what you want to find. That space in your head, in yourself, which would be less rocked by what's going on outside so much. Even the dirty dishes in your sink, if they're your responsibility, you know?
Cool.
Yeah, so.
Thanks.
But it's a good question. It's a really good question. And sometimes I found that I had to go to a different space just to get a different perspective on it, you know?
Yeah.
But if I didn't have that different space to go to, I'd find that different perspective at my regular writing space.
I mean, if I wrote a scene after I worked out for an hour,
right,
and I was in a really busy place,
right,
versus if I like wrote the same scene when I just woke up in my house, there'd be like a different rhythm to it.
That's good to know. That's good to know for you. And so, if you want to have a consistent tone in your writing, you might want to think, let me always write after I work out, or you know, you kind of get in touch with your. For me, I try to plug into the inner thing, which is less changing.
Okay.
Yeah, it's more connected to the story and the characters and all that kind of stuff. But it's very good to know this about yourself. Yeah, because definitely. Anybody else?
Really fun to what you're throwing out a question.
Oh,
birthday thing. I was all set to work on a project that I'm working on. But, it might be nice just to work on something just spontaneous and
Birthday. Think about what you might give yourself for your birthday.
Yeah,
it's a different way to think about New Year's resolutions.
Mm-hmm.
What you might, if you can give yourself anything you want to give yourself, what might you give yourself for your birthday? And that's it sort of makes it very specific, you know, because you still could say, I want to go to the gym every day, and by my birthday, I will have a great gym habit or whatever. And you can still do that. But It makes it more specific about you and less about New Year's resolutions.
It's a good warm-up.
It's such a good warm-up to writing.
To writing.
Oh, yeah, that's true.
Asking a question.
Or
something.
Yeah, I think the best warm-up is just to start. I'm very funny about that. Play. I mean, when I get guitar, like warm-up, you know, people do, you know, the exercise. I just like use the actual activity as a warm-up. Whatever works, that's at the end of the day, it's whatever works for you. You know, whatever helps you get your thing going, definitely, that's the most important. That's the thing you've got to do.
Progress with monologues.
Working on.
One of the characters, he's starting to really come into his own.
Right.
And you know, with a backstory, you know, that's coming in to full
right,
in the play
right.
And bumping up against the other characters.
Uh-huh.
That's just the way he is.
Oh, cool.
But it's been interesting. A friend, you know, I share the work with, and, you know, she's like, yeah, you know, she really loves the character.
Right.
You know, and I love writing the character.
Right.
It's like the first character
uh-huh.
that I ever put on paper that I really
right.
enjoyed, you know,
well,
writing
that's great.
About. Yeah.
Well, that's great.
I could hear them in my head. I could hear them in the way older men I know, how they talk.
Uh-huh.
You know,
uh-huh.
I could just hear them. I know, clothes he wear, I know,
uh-huh.
you know, the, it's like I almost know him.
Right.
Yeah, it's just amazing.
Right.
Yeah.
But you do.
Yeah.
You do know him, don't you?
Mm-hmm.
How about that beginning monologue? Maybe you're working on that beginning, is this the piece, the several monologues
yes.
you're working
yes.
at the beginning? How's that
yes.
coming?
What I mean is he's coming in from boom,
he's,
right
from
in. So,
great.
And the thing I'm realizing is that
right.
I don't need to, front loaded so much.
Uh-huh.
I'm gonna let him reveal himself throughout the story slowly. I was really trying to front load everything.
Uh-huh.
I wanted the audience to know everything about him.
Uh-huh.
But he's just so interesting and he's so alive that
right.
you know, I can spread him out a little
uh-huh.
gingerly, you know.
Congratulations.
Yeah,
that must be, it sounds like it's a really good feeling, right?
Yeah, it is great.
I mean, yeah, Phil's been working on this for a while and he would come in and talk about some wrestling that you were doing with your characters.
Yeah.
And it sounds like they're working with you now.
Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah, you know what I did, what I was telling you about, I waited for the inspiration.
Right.
You're talking about the inspiration comes from within.
Right.
You know, lean into it.
Yeah.
And that's what I was doing. You know, and like, one day he just, I just started hearing it, you know?
Right.
His voice.
Right.
And I started imitating his voice. With my friend, and she's like, wow, that's him.
That's really
so
great.
I just like, he's just he's a collection of a lot of people I've known throughout
uh-huh,
my life,
uh-huh.
you know, older people.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
I just know him. You know, I know
that's
him.
So great. That's so great. Yeah, you were because you were like, yeah, you were waiting, and it was, you were leaning into it. But can you? Because I know now that you're really into it now, right? And it's the character's really with you. Can you talk about what it felt like before the character was really with you? I mean, what did it feel like physically? You know what I'm talking about? Was it like a?
I felt more like a dread. You know what I mean?
Right.
To approach the writing.
Right.
Because I felt like there was a lot missing,
right.
you know, like in the story.
Right.
But I realized that he really at the heart of the story.
Right.
And like it's like all the pieces are like snatching and flying.
Right.
It's like a magnetic attraction. It's like
right.
He's being fleshed out.
Uh-huh.
You know?
Uh-huh.
But I feel like physically, I don't feel it like. Like I said, it was always a dread, you know, to
right.
go there, but I'm like trying to figure it out. but like it just helped knowing that I know him.
Right.
I know the character.
Right.
You know, it's like I know how he's gonna react when a younger person asks him a question.
Right.
And he doesn't know the answer, but to hide the fact that he doesn't know, he's gonna mm-hmm. tell them, well, look it up mm-hmm. in the book. Mm-hmm. You know what mm-hmm. I mean? Uh-huh. I know people that
uh-huh.
know people.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
And so like it's more enjoyable.
Right, right. It's more enjoyable now, but before you got to that enjoyable part, mm-hmm. you felt the dread.
Yeah.
That a lot of us, when we feel like we can't get to it, we feel that same dread. That like it's like an elephant's got his foot on your chest, or this horrible like feeling.
Yeah.
And what you do is you persevere, and you use grit and resilience, and you lean into it a little bit. And the dread gives way to joy. And it happens over and over and over and over and over. For you, for any writer, any artist who's ever made anything, that happens at some point in our careers, that you have to deal with this dread and you have to really wrestle with it and push back against it, or maybe those aren't the right words, but you have to just acknowledge it and keep showing up. And then it's replaced by a joy, a real joy. I mean, the light around you is like, yeah,
it's great.
It's really great.
There's been times I felt really rotten, and that's
right.
been the only thing that buoyed me.
Right.
Knowing that when I get back, I'm going to mess with this cat. You know, we're going to work.
That's great.
Like the light of the day.
That's really great.
Yeah.
That's really great. Yeah, and that, right. And so the light spreads from your work into you, and you can carry it all through your day. Right. And also, when you start sharing it with more and more people, we can carry it through our day. Because that light in what you're writing is communicable. It communicates to us. And that's how art works. That's really great. Yay, Happy New Year. All right, yeah, really. I know. It's really great. But that's exactly, but we all go through that, you know. We all go through that. And if you've gone through it once, you can probably look forward to going through it again. And it doesn't make it any easier in a way to say, oh, I went through that, you know, last year when I was writing such and such. It's still feels like it will never come through. It still feels like you'll never figure it out. A character will never speak to you, you know? But it's always, 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 if you show up and put the work in, the characters are waiting for you on the other side, or the work is waiting for you with the right amount of perseverance and diligence. Yeah, Carol.
I had this... I have a friend who is covering somebody in Angels in America.
Okay.
And so I was running lines with them.
Right.
And I have seen Angels a number of times.
Right.
But, and I think it's amazing. But I've never seen it on the page.
Uh-huh.
And in seeing it on the page, it was like a revelation.
Uh-huh.
If the genius of it was, I the masterful genius
right.
of the this word following that word very
right.
particularly.
Right.
I mean, and my heart went, you know, because when you see something, it's a different experience
mm-hmm.
for me.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, oh my God, that's. And I guess because I'm just a terribly insecure person, I'm Carol. I thought, well, that's writing.
Right.
And I couldn't write that night.
Right, and that's
tricky.
It's a tricky thing. You always have to remind ourselves that what you see on the page, especially Angels, what was Angels written?
Pardon me?
Early 90s? Yeah, 98, 97, whatever. Early, 90-something, right? We always have to remind ourselves that what we see in books did not come out like that. It didn't come out like that. It didn't. Okay? Plays like Angels have been done many, 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 many times and honed and crafted and polished and. So we just have to remind ourselves of that, that it didn't come out like that. That not to deny the genius and the mastery and all that, not to deny that at all, but if we, let's make a blanket rule that anything that makes you go, oh, I can't write today, is like bullshit. I'm just going to be like a sweeping generalization. Anything. I have to do the dishes. I have to feed my cat. My cat has to go to bed. I can't write today. Anything that ends in the sentence, I can't write today. I can't do my work today. It's bullshit. That's bullshit. It's resistance. It's bullshit. And you just need to strike out that part of the sentence of your belief. If you're believing that, then you're not helping yourself. And I love that you brought that up because we all do that. We all have some version of that, you know? I gotta clean my apartment. I gotta go to these meetings. I have to whatever. I can't get my work done today. And we make those kinds of excuses, and then before we know it, the month is over, and we haven't gotten nearly as much of our work done as we had hoped.
Distance from that, the harder it gets.
Exactly. So it's bullshit. So next time you find yourself finishing a sentence with, and so I can't do my, that felt like you can draw a line, fill in the blank, and so I can't do my work today. If that's the end of the sentence, then what comes before that is, you can circle it and say, bullshit. It's bullshit. You can look at it in the eye and say, you're bullshit. I'm just pointing to nothing.
I thought it was someone that was dead.
It looks real, isn't it? You're bullshit. You're bullshit. You're full of shit. And shut up. Get out of my way. Talk to the hand. Whatever magical powers you've got, and we've all got them. Where's he? Look at him. Apply it to that thing, whatever it is. Or my mom called me today and she got me in a bad mood. My spouse had a hangnail and he sent me to bed. I gotta clean the tub. The babysitter didn't show up. Whatever it is. It's bullshit. It is, right?
There was one other thing.
Yes.
Often when I'm here, people talk about they're doing research.
Research. Right.
Well, I think everybody should read Angels, at least one part of it, to see how a master does research, but he gives you the experience, not the research. Do you know what I mean? It was like, so you could see all the work and the research that went into it, but it's not, it's just alive with humanity.
Right.
I was like, whoa. It's just one. And humbling, I might add.
But when it dropped, it's good to be humble, but when it drops you below, you say, I can't do my work because I'm still talking about angels. It's good to talk about angels, but that amount of interest in someone else's work is not helping you at the end of the day. It's not.
But when I read your work, I'm inspired, but I get that same place. You know.
I would say
maybe I should stop reading.
No, really.
Really?
Take a break. Guess what? You might not need to read so much of other people's work. Guess what? You might need to do more of your own. I swear, it's anything that gets in your way.
say, like, what has helped me, still helps me, but, like, I know what you were saying about when you, like, away from it for a while and it gets kind of dry.
Right, right.
And you don't know how to key back into it. What always keys me back into it is that, like, the original thoughts that I had about it, I still have it.
Uh-huh.
I know it's in there somewhere.
Right.
But I just keep reading the thing over and over. Over and over. And then it's like I said, like those spirits, that flesh and flesh starts flying back in from different
uh-huh.
places.
Uh-huh.
And that helps me just going over it over and over, over and over. You know, because it's still there. You know, it's still there. Just it's inside, you know, and it's not gonna leave. You know, you gotta worry about it leaving, but you know, just keep reading it over and over, over and over.
That's great. Or if you can't bear to read it over and over, if you can't bear, because that's brave to read your work over and over.
Yeah.
You can't bear. Just make a list of the characters. Just make yourself a list of the characters. You don't even have to look at the page. So looking at the page is very graceful. If you don't have that love, you can't bring yourself to them, just make a list of the characters. I love her. Maybe her name is Sally. Sally, I love you because you're whatever. Or Fred. Fred, you know, whatever. Make a list of the characters and maybe talk to yourself about them. You see what I'm saying? So, but that's a great suggestion. And there are variations on that that you can do according to your ability to face your work. And sometimes you can't face it straight on like this. You kind of need to look at it like that, kind of go along.
Got a question from Twitter.
Yeah.
Crystal Adams in New Jersey.
Oh, Crystal from New Jersey. Yay! Hey, Crystal.
Hey, Crystal.
Happy New Year, Crystal.
Everyone says okay. Hi, Crystal. She says, I'm hearing new characters, but I don't have a story or setting or even a conflict. What do I do with them? Where do I put them? How do I even start a story?
A story like a play? It doesn't matter what kind of story. Oh, great. So you're hearing new characters. Crystal, do you know their names? I mean, it's okay. We'll just ask her. She'll think of it on him. Crystal, if you can hear some names for those characters, right? And then you can just start having conversations with them, like you could interview them. So one's name is Rose. Hey, Rose. You know, you can ask her questions, like you're going on a speed date or something, or a longer date, right? You sit around and you can talk to them. You can actually interview your characters. That's a great way to get to know them. And maybe by interviewing your characters one by one, they will start to reveal some kind of story. Maybe you could ask them questions like, what do you want in anything?
Yes.
That's a good question for a character in a play, a movie, a novel. What do you want more than anything? And what are you going to do to get it? Ask them questions like that. And that will reveal some kind of story. You know? That's great. Congratulations. I'm meeting some new characters. Happy New Year, Crystal.
Yeah.
Yeah, we miss you and we adore you. That sounds like fun.
Something to add, I guess, to the discussion about writing every day.
Yeah.
If anyone has time or the ability to see the new Adrian Kennedy piece at Theatre for a New Audience, it was fantastic. I took the students, I teach there, everyone. It was a really great show. But she has it, that's her first original play for 10 years, and she wrote it in 6 weeks. She said in this interview in the New York Times, but she said that she was taking notes every day. That's how she described it. So she was just doing free-form writing every day, usually between 3 and 5 in the morning, she said. And so even though the play only took 6 weeks, she was writing every day random shit every day for 10 years.
Right.
And that is all informed the play. So I don't know, I sometimes try that. Like instead of character, I write about a history or do like history research. I don't know, just something where you're expressing your ideas and interests. That like maybe like speaks to the research that you're talking about, the reasons that it seems so under the surface in Angels. is because he had all that knowledge, and then when he sat down to write the play, he knew it so well that he didn't have to be like, oh, and then a statistic here, because he knew it well.
And who
was
that? Adrian Kennedy. The fabulous Adrian Kennedy. What's the name of the new play?
He brought her heart back in a box. Theater for the audience. He brought her heart back in a box.
He brought her heart back in a box. Adrian Kennedy is one of the great American writers. Yeah, she's fantastic. She's fantastic. You've seen it. I haven't seen it. I got to see it. She's a great writer. Theater for the new audience.
It's in beside BAM in the Brooklyn Cultural District area.
Yeah,
sure. Ashland Plays.
Yeah. Oh, thanks.
How long is it
going? Till I'm not sure. Till but like easily for another 3 weeks because I only really opened on the weekend.
Okay. Great. She's a great writer. So I'm glad.
I like what you said about reading less or consuming less.
Right.
I find something that's hard for me is living in New York, there's just so much stimulus all the time. And I think in our culture we're told that like consuming things is what is like relaxation or pleasure. You know, like consuming television or consuming food or alcohol or whatever. But we're just like bombarded.
Don't you feel battered by it all?
I mean, I love reading and listening to music, but I find I don't write as much music, or I don't write as much if I'm reading so much, because it's like only so much can come out if so much is going in all the time. I don't know. That's all I have to say.
Consuming.
Yeah.
In my experience, consumption is a form of anxiety. I remember when the World Trade Center fell and the directive was go shopping.
Right.
Because we wanted to get the economy back on track, we wanted to show them where they are, that we're okay, so go shopping to show that you're all right. It's actually consuming more than you actually need. I think it's actually a function of anxiety. I think there's a lot of stuff going on. I mean, you hear people who are hoarders and they're on the shopping channels buying stuff compulsively. I think there's a lot of anxiety. People try to calm their anxiety by consumption, by buying stuff, by gorging on news, you know, reading the news feeds. I know people who wake up in the morning. Some of my students over the years have told me they wake up and I hit my news feed and they're on Facebook, Twitter, you name it. They're ingesting it before they even really get out of bed. I think that's a function of anxiety. And it's okay. It's okay. Let us now recognize it and make steps to disconnect the two, you know? And I really do. I know that when I'm more anxious, I am reading more of the news feed. Because somehow if I just, you know, I'll be able to do something about it. They're like, I can't do anything about this. It's nuts. Crap. It's going on a lot. No?
That's the best computer I've seen like a few years.
You didn't like this sticker before because you thought it was grammatically unclear.
No, I thought...
Why anyone would
want to
fuck Trump?
Not even his wife. Okay? But no, Stormy, what's her name? Stormy Weather, what's
her
name?
Oh, Stormy, yeah, yeah.
That's a song. Stormy Monday. No, that's Stormy not her name.
I don't know why there's no sun up in the sky.
Daniels,
is that her name?
Yeah, that's her name. I was going to go through every Stormy I am.
See, that's part of this, it feels like a cloud over us all.
Right.
And as artists, I mean, it's really, every artist, every emerging artist, or older artist, you wake up in the morning and, you know, you want to, it's just devastating. The Women's March this year was so hopeful. That day was so needed. It was so, because it was different. There were men and young women. Mm-hmm. Last year, there was this division between Bernie and Hillary, so the coming out of people was not the same.
Right.
It was so full of possibility and hope.
Right.
You know, and then, excuse me, he opens his fucking mouth.
No, no, no. If it keeps you from doing your work, what is it?
Bullshit.
Right. Period. You know, you need an intervention. You need an intervention. You really do. It's an opportunity to up your focus game. It's not saying it doesn't exist. It's not saying it's not important. It's not saying that there's not a cloud up in the sky, right? It is also an opportunity for you to up your focus game. It is. That's what it is. If you were going to allow it to get in the way of you doing your work, then, you know, 3 years from now, whatever, you're going to be... Right? You got to make a decision. Right? Not to deny the existence of difficulty, but if I start talking to you about all the difficulties going on, and I mean, really, what? You know what I'm saying?
I like it,
but I like it.
It's the routine. Self-care makes me happy when I turn it on.
Exactly.
So I look at it and then I like register it. And then
right.
But I'm not from America, so maybe I'm also seeing it as a different, I don't know.
Well, yeah.
But it does,
maybe,
it helps me.
Maybe. But if it were, then that's the thing. If it's effective for you, then I think it's great. And I don't dislike it. I just like it's
really good. Not something you want to be thinking about.
Yeah. But I think that that's kind of a way that we have to go about thinking, and not just in these times, but. You know, when Obama was president, I know he also made excuses about our work. I know that.
That's true.
Yes. There were also difficulties we had during the day getting our work done. Guess what? Yeah. Own it. And we must just keep moving forward. And that's it. And it is hard. It is. And it sucks. And you want to slap somebody. What are we going to do now? It's time to go. I'm going to go get some more work. I hope the rest of you do too. Okay? We'll see you back here next week if you're around. We'll be back next week again. Thanks, Augie. Thanks, Avery. Thanks, guys.